Station, this is Christa McAuliffe Challenger Center. How do you hear me?
Hello, welcome to the International Space Station. We have you loud and clear.
Fantastic. Hey, Joe, I want to turn this over very quickly to these students. They have a lot of great questions, but I just want to personally thank you and the crew, you personally, for really being a key part of kicking off this announcement and this project we're doing over the next year. So thank you very much, Joe.
Hey, you're very welcome. And, you know, it's been 32 years since we lost the Challenger crew. One of them was, of course, Christa McAuliffe, the first teacher in space. And so I can't think of a better time or a better place to make this announcement than at Framingham State University. That was Christa's alma mater. And so what I'd like to announce is that Ricky Arnold and I, over the next several months, we'll be working with the Challenger Center to record several of Christa's original lesson plans that she was going to do in space. And we're looking forward to sharing that with educators and students around the world. It really is going to be a pleasure working with you all, and we look forward to helping to inspire the next generation of explorers and educators. So thank you very much, and we are ready for some questions.
Thank you, Joe.
All right, Expedition 54. Our first question for you is from Erica.
With an international crew among the ISS, many of the astronauts come from different backgrounds and moral understandings. How do crew members address conflict aboard the ISS, considering the diversity of all members?
Well, I think we have more in common than you would imagine. So really, the diversity is good for the crew, but the main thing when we do have any kind of an issue is to have open communication.
All right, our next question for you gentlemen is from Marquise.
Hi, my question is, when there's a difference in opinion, how do you advocate your position or opinion?
Well, you know, you want to get the best decision. You want to meet mission objectives. You don't really want to advocate for your position unless you really think that it's a really good position for good reasons. So back to what Joe said, we have open communications. You just sit down and have an open and honest discussion, and you take all of the facts and your considerations from all of the folks involved, and the team makes a good decision.
Our next question is from Grace.
You go through so much training for your journey. Is there one thing that you were not prepared for?
I was a medical doctor before becoming an astronaut, so everything in space program and ISS, everything is new for me. So I was totally unprepared for everything.
Our next question is from Michelle.
In touch with your family while in space?
Well, I think I actually talk to my family more while I'm in space than I do when I'm back home. We have a video conference once a week, so I'm able to communicate with the family that way. And we also have email, and we have the best phone off the planet where I can call them, but they can't call me.
Our next question is from Nicole.
All right. I work at the Challenger Center on campus and was wondering, what do you think the benefits are for having simulations at centers like this for children who attend?
I think simulations are a valuable tool for folks to get in and see what working with space systems are like. And most importantly, it's absolutely the most fun that they'll probably have with any toy that they have.
Our next question is from Suzanne.
How aware of current events are you while on board the ISS?
As Joe mentioned, we have a telephone, a video conference, so we can talk with our family members, email, and we can even watch TV news on orbit. The ground controller uplink the video file for us.
Next question is from John.
Are there any funny pranks that can only be done in space?
Well, there's probably a lot, and one that I haven't done yet, but I'd like to before I leave, is in the middle of the night, see if we can get somebody out of their crew quarters and put them in a module somewhere, see where they end up in the morning, and see their reaction when they wake up not in their crew quarters.
Our next question is from Anna.
Hello. As an emergency room nurse, I wonder what sort of training do you go through to handle medical emergencies in space? I imagine the response time for most emergencies from Earth is a bit long for most scenarios, and that many common practices would have to be adapted to the microgravity realm.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Very important question, and it's a very important part of our training. We spend several years dabbling in medical care and the critical procedures. And then once we're assigned, we spend a lot of time with practical classes and working through all the critical cases. Also, we spend a good weekend working the night shift at a local emergency room. And I've actually sewed people up and helped them recover from trauma. So it's a really good program, and it's really thorough.
Our next question is from Jillian.
What are potential applications of plants in space that you foresee in the future?
In the future, so maybe I'm watching too many SF movies, but I'm dreaming about a space agriculture or space plants for the future space program.
Next question is from Holly.
Hi. Do your taste buds change?
I don't think mine change too much. I hear some people's taste buds change and they want to use more salsa or some kind of add a kick to their food. But for me, it stayed pretty steady, and I think the food is pretty good up here, so I'm happy.
Next, we have Katie.
Do you sweat in space?
You bet, we do. All our sweating is a critical part of our body's cooling system, so it's critical that it works properly. So when we're working out and we get hot, we sweat, just like we would down on Earth. But normally they keep the space station at a very nice temperature, so there isn't a whole lot of need to sweat, so we minimize the need there.
Next we have Eric.
Hi. What is the coolest science experiment that you've ever seen done on the space station?
Yes, I have a sensor on my forehead, and it's not so cool by looking outside. But this sensor is very smart and measuring my core temperature, and the researchers on the ground can measure my circadian rhythm. That's a very cool experiment.
Next, we have Cam.
Hello. In your opinion, what is the most exciting project you're currently working on aboard the ISS? And what is the ultimate goal of that project?
Wow, that's a great question. And we have literally hundreds of experiments going on at any given time. But just recently, I was working on an experiment in which we were looking at bone cells and adding a chemical to the bone cell that would help heal bone. And so we're checking that out here on the space station to see if we can use that for people that might either have broken bones or they have some kind of a metal implant. So that was pretty cool to be a part of that.
Next, we have Kathleen.
Hi. How has your length of time in space affected your body and its functions?
Well, after first arriving in space, you go through some pretty big changes. Your body's going from one G of gravity to zero Gs, and we get a little bit of a fluid shift, and so our faces get a little puffy, and we start holding our shoulders stand up like this a little bit. But after a month or so, you get really adjusted, and everything's kind of back to normal. One other side effect is our spines tend to extend just a little bit because we don't have gravity pulling us down. And I'll tell you what, my back has never felt better.
Next, we have a question from Icaro.
What challenge have you faced that was unexpected or made you approach daily life in a new way?
You know, the life in space station is very interesting. Every day I found something interesting. I see something new. I know something very interesting. So every day it's challenges, and it's a good challenges.
Our next question is from Jesse.
Hey, so what was your first thought when you went up and you got to see this big blue planet that you've been on all your life and have spent it with billions of other people? What was your first thought, and has your views changed?
My first thought was, wow. I just couldn't believe that I was here looking at the Earth. And then it is amazing how beautiful it is. And did it change my views? I think I've always thought about the planet, how fragile it is, and protecting it. But when you step back a little bit and you see it from a couple of hundred miles away, that really becomes real. And you can truly see the atmosphere. You can see how everything is connected. And it makes me want to work even harder to try to protect our beautiful home.
Our next question is from Eric.
Afternoon. Do you guys have the same concept of quote-unquote days and nights? And also, how often do you stay awake, and when do you guys go to sleep?
So, you know, if you go with a technical definition of days and nights, we see about 16 to 18 of them every day. Because of the orbits that we're in, going to the dark side and then the light side, in and out of the sun. But as far as the work function goes, we operate on Greenwich Mean Time, and so we work during our day, which are normal work hours, and then we sleep during our sleep during the normal sleep hours, even though outside's getting light and dark about every 45 minutes for each half cycle.
All right, our next question is from David.
What books are you currently reading?
Oh, I'm too busy right now for doing lots of sciences, lots of tasks, so I have no time for reading, unfortunately. I like reading, though.
We have another question about reading from Jackie.
Did you ever read science fiction or fantasy growing up?
Most definitely. I read a lot of it, and what was pretty cool was in my, I think it was in the middle school in seventh grade, they actually had a science fiction reading class, and so I took that. So yeah, I've been reading sci-fi for a long time and just love the imagination, thinking of going to other planets. I've gotten here, but there's a lot more places I'd like to go.
Our next question is from Lydia.
Is there a space-themed body of work, either a film, album, or book, that is meaningful to you?
Well, for me, it's all about the documentaries. I've been into the space program for a long time, so I like the documentaries on Apollo. I like the documentaries on the early phases of the space program, such as the Soyuz program and things like that. So, documentaries.
All right. Our next question was submitted by Scott.
What or who inspired you to become an astronaut, and who provided the support you need to accomplish your goals?
So So I remember when I was elementary school, the first Japanese astronaut flown on space shuttle. That was very, very exciting news all over in Japan. He actually inspired me to become an astronaut.
Our next question is from Gabrielle.
I would like to be an astronaut one day. If you were rejected and had to reapply, what did you do differently to stand out of the application pool?
So I was pretty fortunate that I was accepted the first time that I applied. And I don't think it's so much of what you have to change. There are so many things that go into being selected. Depends on what the astronaut office is looking for. It depends on who else is applying with you. So I would just say, you know, study what you love, be the best that you can be. And when you live up here for 6 months, one of the most important qualities you can have is just being a nice person so you can work with other people.
Our next question is from Cameron.
Hi. If another space station were built, what major improvements would you want to see from an engineering design standpoint or other?
How much time?
Boy, we could talk about that for a long time. I'd like to see better human integration. We've been flying in space for a long time, and back when they designed all these systems, they did a great job doing them, but we have a lot of experience now, and we should be able to control the complexity. We should have better human interfaces so that the systems are more intuitive and so that we could minimize training to be able to come up here and use them effectively and efficiently.
Our next question is from Lydia.
What are some ways you stay connected to the culture you belong to while on board the ISS?
I like eating, so I brought up lots of Japanese food and share that Japanese food with my crewmates and enjoying the taste from Japan.
Our next question is from Cameron.
Are there concepts in mathematics that are particularly helpful in space?
Well, luckily, by the time we get here, all of that complex mathematics has been done. And, you know, that goes into the design of the space station. And so for us, on a day-to-day basis, we're not required to do that, which is good for me. I love math, but they make things as simple as they can for us. But it is the, you know, math is a language. That's the basis for almost everything we do. And so being able to do it is super important, and it has gotten us where we are today.
We have another question from Cameron.
Christa McAuliffe planned on keeping a journal while she was in space. Do you plan on keeping a daily journal on the ISS?
They handed it back to me because they know that I keep one. And actually, when I was first hired by NASA, NASA Education gave me a nice leather-bound journal. And so ever since then, I've been keeping that journal. So for the last, I guess, 13, 14 years, I've been writing in it. And every night before I go to bed, I try to spend a few minutes. So, yep, I'm keeping the journal. And when I'm sitting on my porch sometime in the future, I'll look back on all these great times.
That concludes our questions for you today, gentlemen. Thank you for your time and helping us celebrate the legacy of the Challenger 7.
Thanks for joining us today. It was a pleasure, and it's always great working with you, and have a great weekend, and we'll see you soon.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event.
Thank you to all participants from the Christa McAuliffe Challenger Center. Station, we are now resuming operational audio comm.